This is Spencer with the MacGuffin, and today I'm joined by some of the folks behind Chicago Girl. We've got Joe Piscatella, and Ala Bazatne.
Bazatne.
Okay. I was in the ballpark. I consider that a bit of a moral victory, but getting down to the film itself, the film is a documentary, I don't know, how would you describe it, of a group of people led by Ala who are involved in the Syrian revolution and their stories as they go through this experience.
I'm going to cut in.
Sure.
Led by me. I helped.
Well, yeah. Sorry. I did not want to say this was like your... but it's a group of individuals within this who you are part of. And
exactly.
It's the different stories that is being told to try and make it clear. I guess we should start with sort of the genesis of this film. A, how did this come to your desk, Joe? And for you, like... what was your perspective when they came to you and were like, we kind of want to make this film? Were you skeptical? Were you receptive just as another avenue to get information out? How did this sort of begin, so to speak?
The genesis of the film started where I wanted to make a documentary about technology and revolution. This was right after Tunisia had fallen, right after Egypt had fallen, Egypt had fallen the first time, and both, you know, very socially media-driven revolutions. But I wanted to find a personal story or a set of personal stories to kind of put a face on all of this. And so I read about this death threat that Ala had gotten. I was in a blurb in a small newspaper, so I naturally found her on Facebook, and we got on the phone.
Perfect for, you know, the film, you know, if it's right in.
And I said to her, I was asking her questions on the phone about this, and she finally said to me, she said, Joe, you're asking me all the wrong questions. And my initial reaction was, how do you know what questions I should be asking? This is my film. You don't even really know what it's about. And she said, well, I'm one of, you know, I'm helping coordinate certain parts of this revolution. And she explained to me what she did. And my instinct was, I don't believe it, but if it's true, that's an amazing way into a story about a very complicated topic. And so I called my producer, and 2 days later, we flew to Chicago and sat down with Ala for the afternoon, and she coordinated a protest. And we both, my producer and I, realized, all right, this is our entry into this topic.
And for you, Ala, I mean, this is sort of one of the bigger issues, like, in terms of them bringing this to you and just people in general, how did you sort of evaluate what was a good investment of your time, since you had so much going on, that this seems like a legitimate request, these seem like trustworthy people? How did this sort of become something that you agreed to do?
The way I thought of it right away is it's a great method to show the upcoming generations in Syria what their parents have been through in order for them to have achieved the freedom and democracy. So I looked at it in perspective down the, like, way down the road, those children are going to end up seeing this documentary, and they're going to learn about Basil and Omar, and back then I didn't know who's exactly going to be in this documentary, but knowing that it's going to be about the Syrian revolution and it's about activism.
So one of the things that I found interesting is that you were helping to coordinate all this, which is obviously one of the major parts of the film. You had all sorts of different sources. You had an Excel spreadsheet, it looked like, where you were saying, you know, person, location, what you wanted to do with them. What was it like? I mean, okay, so Joe passed the test. You know, he seemed like a reliable guy. What was it like trying to evaluate all those people on the ground? Because it seemed like you were someone who was privy to a lot of information, and it could be something, you know, I don't know what you would call them, double agents, people trying to get that information from you. What was it like trying to sort of manage that information and make sure that everyone you were interacting with was safe and everyone that you were interacting with was a legitimate source of information?
Well, to start off, the list was just the activists that I really became close with, and I wanted to meet them in Syria. This was one of the motivations for me to look at that list and say, okay, when the revolution succeeds and I go back to Syria, I'm going to see this activist at this place, and we're going to do this. But just to throw it out there, unfortunately, 75% of the people on that list are dead now. They're killed by the Syrian regime. I don't even open that list anymore.
Wow. I mean, there was an anecdote to that. We were doing a pickup interview with Allah. This was, well, now it's been 18 months, but we were doing this pickup interview, and we just needed to get some shots of her on her computer. And so we were kind of doing an over-the-shoulder shot and kind of watching her scroll through her Facebook names, and a DP got the shot, and they were kind of wrapping up, and Allah was very quiet, which for Allah is very unusual. And I kind of said, you know, hey, Ola, what's up? And she's like, you know, it's the first time I've really kind of scrolled through my whole Facebook network in a long time and just realizing how many of these people are gone. It was kind of heartbreaking. I mean, as a filmmaker, I was like, why did we not have the camera rolling to get that emotion? And as a friend, it was just like, that's got to be heartbreaking to be able to look at your friends list and realize so many of them just aren't there anymore.
Well, that's an interesting point right there. For you, Joe, what was it like for you? I mean, you were talking about the interesting intersection of technology and, you know, these revolutions. As you were making this movie, did it really change your perspective of the Syrian revolution as you got? I mean, you were probably as deeply inside it as like any real journalist was. Did it change what you thought beforehand, what you thought as it went on? Like, how did your views of it evolve during this process?
It changed my perspective of the Syrian revolution and what they are fighting for. Didn't change. I mean, I certainly support anybody who's, you know, trying to bring democracy and freedom to their own country. What changed for me was my perspective of the role of social media. I mean, when we started this film, we had assumed, oh, this will take us a couple of months. It's going to be just like Egypt. It's the next to fall. Our movie is going to end with a triumphant victory. All is going to go back to Syria. She's going to meet all of her friends on her list. What an amazing ending. And as the film, you know, as that didn't happen and the revolution continued to go on and the violence continued to happen, my realization was, you know, social media is a really powerful tool, but you gotta, it takes more than that. I mean, you've gotta be able, you can organize on social media, but you gotta be willing to stand up and go into the street and fight for what you believe in to make a difference, because you can't just click like and say, I did my part, and it's now gonna happen, because I don't think it happens that way.
So in terms of your involvement in the organization side of things, Ala, I mean, you talk about in the beginning of the film that you're just, you know, a high school girl who liked to go to the malls and hang out with friends and all that sort of stuff when before this all began. What exactly was it that finally connected with you that you're like, all right, this is something I want to spend my time doing? And once you did start spending your time, like, what was it that so completely caught a hold of you that you essentially started spending all your time doing this?
Mm-hmm. So in the beginning of the revolution, I would help the community in Chicago organize protests in downtown Chicago and try to raise awareness of what's going on in Syria. But then it got bigger to up to the point where several states were protesting at the same time, and we called it a national protest for the Syrian revolution. It was up to one protest in front of the White House that I helped organize. And we were there protesting, and the Libyans were there protesting, and the media only went to the Libyans. So I stopped and I said, that's not fair. Why is the media doing this? We need to work even harder to get the attention of the media. So I went back home and I noticed that some of the protesters were approaching me on Skype and saying, can you translate this for us really quick? Because we want the banners to be in English so we can end up on media outlets faster, and we can ensure that it goes like on CNN and BBC. And little by little, I noticed myself doing more, spending more hours online and helping the activists on the ground.
One of the things that was interesting to me is I definitely can empathize with the desires, as Joe said. But for me, like, I've grown up in the U.S. my entire life. I've never been in put in a position like you have. You were actually born there. I don't know at what age you left, but what is that experience like for you? I mean, how much do you remember from your childhood there? How much, you know, of your memory of that experience or whatever is, you know, from your parents or community growing up? Like, what exactly is it that has so strongly connected you to Syria, even as somebody who's probably been gone for, I don't know, a decade now or something?
Yeah, I actually was born in Damascus, Syria, and then I spent kindergarten in there, and that was about it. So growing up in Chicago, my parents always talked about Syria. I mean, they truly left their soul and their heart and everything in Syria when they left. So I grew up sitting next to my dad and watching the news every day, learning more about the Assad family and the oppression that's happening from underneath the table that no one knows about, but it's no one knows about it in the international community, but everyone knows about it in Syria. And the breaking point for me was when I saw the children of Daraa. It's a small city, 40 minutes drive from Damascus, the capital, and that a bunch of school students decided to write, "We want to topple the regime," on their school walls. And that's when the principal had to call the police, and the police took them and detained them and tortured them. And when I heard that and I saw pictures of the children when they were released, it didn't seem fair at all for me to say, okay, I saw those pictures, I'm going to the mall now. It wasn't right at all. I had to do something about it. And that's when I said, I'm dedicating anything and everything I can do to help the activists on the ground.
For you, Joe, in terms of actually making this film, I mean, a huge part of the film is built upon citizen journalism footage from Syria, which is phenomenal. But what was it like for you? Like, how did you go about, you know, documenting? This is something that's going on for, I don't know, I think the filming goes over the course of at least a year, it seemed like.
It's about 2 years.
About 2 years, okay. Yeah. So, and even since then, it's gone on beyond that. So what was it like for you in terms of trying to make this film, in terms of trying to figure out what to document? Were you literally just following her around like 24 hours a day, or were you periodically coming back?
No, we were periodically going to Chicago to film her. You know, around the same time we started filming Alla, I met Basil, and we had been trying for a while of, okay, who can we get to film over there? It wasn't something I couldn't just go into Syria with a camera. And so we were trying to find who's somebody that's already there that can do this. And there was a professor at Syracuse who we were talking to as a potential talking head for the film. And he said, oh, I had this student, his name's Basil, you guys should meet him. He's really a talented filmmaker. So we started Skyping with Basil, and immediately you just knew he was a filmmaker. I mean, he got it. And so, you know, we asked Basil to be a part of it. And it was, as a director, you know, I was essentially using social media to direct parts of this film. And I would say to Basil, okay, today I know Aus has a protest. Let's try to shoot that. And Basil would say, okay. And I'd say, here are the 25 shots that are on my wish list. What can you realistically get? And he'd say, I can get all of these. It's going to be really dangerous for me to get the last five. And, you know, he would use his own risk assessment of what he could legitimately get and what he couldn't. One of the things we did was we smuggled him in a Canon 7D camera and an iPhone, because he found that there's certain places in Syria, the moment you pull your camera out, they start shooting at you. But he found that with an iPhone, he could actually film some things that he wouldn't be able to get otherwise with a big camera.
Although, what was it like, you know, in terms of bringing other people in to this? I mean, you obviously, we talk about Aus, Basil, and there's Omar as well, who are all major players in the story. What was it like in terms of sort of bringing them in and discussing this project with them? Were they receptive and like it being another avenue for them to be able to tell this story? Or were they at all concerned about this new group that was getting involved with the information? Or what was sort of the response from them in terms of you bringing?
I remember Omar's response, but I don't recall talking to Bessa and Aus about it.
I spoke to Aus about it, and Aus said to me, Basil's my best friend. If Basil trusts you, and Basil wants to make this film with you, then I'm on board. And that was as simple as that.
The minute Omar, I remember, heard that this documentary will be for the West, he said yes. He wanted the West and the people in America to know what's going on in the streets of Homs and Damascus.
And one of the things that's interesting, you spoke about that your role has been like, they would send footage from Syria, you would download it, blur out faces, translate stuff, make it more digestible to Western audiences. How have you noticed that impacting the results you've gotten from these protests? Like, as you said, you know, you went to Washington and they just focused on the Libyan protests and stuff like that. Have you noticed like an increase in traction since you guys have been trying to make this more consumable to Western audiences?
Yeah, for a certain period, minutes after I send CNN a protest, it will end up breaking news. I've seen it happen several times. Al Jazeera at the same time, Al Arabiya. And that satisfaction of that feeling of satisfaction of yes, I got it. I was part of this. I helped get this on the screen, so millions are seeing it right now. It's hard to say fulfilling because people are still at risk and they're still dying. But it gave me a feeling of yes, you're helping.
There's an addition to that I found really interesting. And at one point we had a section on it in the film, and over the course of editing we had to remove it. But in Syria there is, you know, the government controls the media. And so what was happening with some of this is Allah or somebody like Allah, an expatriate, would get these videos. They'd make it more digestible or more palatable for a Western audience. It would go out on Al Jazeera. And then Syrians within Syria who have satellite television were now picking this broadcast up. Yeah. And so they were basically seeing what's going on in their own country, but the news had to travel all the way around the world and back again to get to them.
Has this experience influenced the way you guys look at other situations? For instance, you talk about like the Libyans, or, you know, obviously North Korea gets a lot of news. There's any number of global situations going on at the time. Has it altered the way that you look at them, and or what has that challenge of there being so many different global issues going on at the same time impacted the way that you're handling the situation? Because obviously, you know, you guys want help for Syria. I think, you know, when people see this film, they rightly would want to support and help as much as they can. But at the same time, there's so many different things going on. What is the dealing with the, I don't know what you call it, information overload, to put in sort of like a media context? What is sort of like your response to that, since you guys have been put in a position to sort of speak about this subject?
To be honest with you, it's one of the reasons why we made the film was we're finding that with Syria, there was very much, especially to an American audience, when you talk about Syria, and even to people who are fairly well educated on the topic, it's the sense of it's those people over there fighting again over something that doesn't really affect me. And one of the reasons why I chose focusing on a social network of young people was it's putting a face on that conflict. It isn't just those people. It's just like the kid that lives down the street from you, and just like your son or, you know, your own children. And in terms of the overload, you're absolutely right. It's just, if you look at it just in terms of Syria, there's overload. I mean, now the only way it makes headlines is if there's a major massacre, or the chemical weapons have been used. The daily 400 people died today no longer make the headlines because we've all seen them every day. And at some point people say, I get it, I'm moving on. And so it's, you know, constantly, how do you get people to continue to engage on it and continue to either keep the conversation going, or if they are uneducated on the topic, educate them so they can join the conversation?
One of the things I found very interesting was sort of the historical context which you set. You know, you talk about how the regime came, specifically how Bashar al-Assad came to power. You also talked about, you know, in the past how his father had completely destroyed Hama, and that led into the destruction of Homs. What is it like sort of seeing these parallels occurring historically? I mean, in some ways, it sort of seems depressing because history literally is reliving itself. Like, have there been other, I mean, I guess the Egyptian and the Tunisian revolutions give you hope, but at the same time, at what point do you think you'll feel like there's been a corner turned and things are actually getting progressively better? I mean, obviously getting the word out is step one, but it seems like it's probably 100-step journey to the end or something like that.
Yeah, or a 1,000-step journey. All of will speak to this more intelligently than I can, but one of the things that has also changed for me in making this film is the realization of just how difficult this is to achieve. I mean, even if you're looking at Tunisia and Egypt, yes, their governments fell, but that's when the hard work really starts is after that.
Yeah.
And it isn't even so much for me a question of then what, because I think I would rather have the then what question mark as opposed to, well, let's keep it to where we were at. But I think that you just realize, you know, there's a difference between democracy and a stable democracy. And even if you look at our own nation's history, you know, there was not instant stability in 1777 after the revolution. We all forget it probably took a period of many, many years before it was finally a stable democracy. And it's just that realization of it's not instant. You don't just topple a dictator and suddenly here's freedom. It's a very long road.
And the fact that people like Aus and Aus are still in the country and they're still protesting every Friday, they started this revolution and they won't stop till they either die or they achieve the victory. And the way I look at it, it's that the Syrians are walking in a very dark tunnel. The more people are raising awareness and talking about the situation, they're holding up the light. They're leading the protesters' way and the activists' way. We do see the light at the end of the tunnel, but we don't know how long it will take.
And something that I found really interesting just since we've been here in Seattle is, you know, there's always this question of, you know, we were just in high schools, and high school kids say, well, what can we do? I'm a high school student. What can we do to help? And one of the things we have said was, you know, start tweeting about it. And I know that sounds silly and I know that sounds trivial, but, you know, yesterday and today, Aus, who's still in Syria, who's, you know, a character in our film, has been reading all the tweets, and he's been sending back all of these amazing messages of, you know, I'm in tears. I am so touched. I mean, there are people in Seattle that care about me and they care about what's going on here. And that's been one of the most moving parts of us being in Seattle was seeing those messages from Aus and realizing something as simple as just a tweet of, hey, we're behind you, or we believe in what you're doing, is meaningful.
From a practicality standpoint, and one that is very depressing kind of in some ways in the film, is that, I mean, one of the things that it seems like you guys want is that you want international support in sort of helping the situation in Syria. Like, there's a vote that occurs at the UN. Apparently, like, nothing comes out of it. I think about even just from a practical standpoint of, like, the U.S. and, like, what's occurred in Iraq and Afghanistan and sort of, like, in some ways, the disasters that have been left there since our arrival. It's sort of like, what can we actually do to help? Because it seems like sometimes we make things not necessarily worse than they are, but much more chaotic than they were before in some ways. What exactly could the international community do that would legitimately help the situation besides just sort of spinning wheels like the UN did?
Well, it's continually putting pressure on the Assad regime of it's got to end. Syria has become increasingly complicated. You know, the more time that goes on, the less the international community can really do other than continue to apply pressure. You know, if anybody was going to have done something, it should have happened when he started bombing his own people. And instead we said, the red line is here now. The red line is now chemical weapons. and then he used chemical weapons. And we've, at this point, he's crossed the red line so many times, and there just isn't international movement. And it's just becoming, you know, exponentially more complicated. And there isn't a simple solution of just, oh, let's snap our fingers and send in SEAL Team 6 and make it happen, because I just don't think that's going to help the situation.
No. And not only that, but also I'm a strong believer of that democracy comes from within. You can't impose it on any nation or any group of people. So it will take a very long time, but it will happen. They will achieve their victory.
It's sort of an interesting statement that, you know, it's going to take a long time. In terms of working in the revolution, and this is sort of a dumb question in some ways, but sort of a legitimate one in others, is it more challenging to actually have sort of a personal connection to a lot of these people? Because it seems like that would be very difficult when, you know, as you said, like 75% of these people are dying. Like, it seems like getting so attached to each individual person is both something that will inspire you, but makes it incredibly difficult to deal with all the time.
Well, I'm dealing with my brothers and sisters. I'm dealing with my own people. It was, I never thought about it of just dealing with activists and that's it. I mean, the more I got to know Omar, the more I got to know Basel, the more I got to know a lot of people, the more I was attached to them. And I in a way that motivated all of us, we would set up, you know, those meetings and say, you know, at the end of the when we achieve victory in the revolution, I'm going to meet you here, we're going to do this, we're going to eat this. And it just, all those hopes and dreams made us keep going.
In terms of the evolution of everyone in this movie, as you said, you know, you social media will only get you so far. At a certain point, you know, people have to do something. What was it like for you, Alaa? I mean, you are coordinating all this stuff from so far away. At a certain point, you put yourself very much in the realm of harm. At what point do you sort of start to feel that way, that, you know, what you're doing is not enough, I need to do more? I mean, it seemed like you were doing so much already to begin with in terms of this whole thing, that you wanted to take it above and beyond what you're already doing.
Well, as people in my network started saying that there isn't medications, there was only 6 insulin shots left in the entire city I visited, and that was liberated areas in Aleppo, and it was not under the Syrian regime's control. And at the same time, the news about the death of Basel was just so overwhelming that I had to take that step. I honestly would have collapsed if I didn't take those medications and walk on a minefield to enter the liberated areas and give the children and the women and the ill people the medications.
How alarming. I mean, you certainly received death threats via Facebook and stuff. At what point, or should I say not point, but what did that sort of trigger when they actually went so far as to have, like, a photographer come all the way to follow you and photograph you? Like, what did that really resonate to you? Like, the extent that they're willing to go for this? Or, I mean, what did that do to you?
That was, for a 19-year-old, that was pretty scary. And I kept it to myself, and I didn't tell my parents for a week about it. And then out of nowhere, I get this email from a close contact of mine in Amnesty International asking if I know anyone in the expatriates community that was threatened by the Syrian regime. And I said, well, I gotta tell you this, but this happened to me. And that's when I said to myself, okay, well, I told someone that's at Amnesty International, I gotta tell my parents as well. It's scary, but the way I look at it is that the Syrian regime can't control 80% of its borders. I mean, they have liberated areas in Syria. So at the same time, it's not fair for me to fear for my life while others in Syria are facing bullets and tanks and TNT barrel bombs as we speak right now.
So the film ends in 2012, I believe.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
The film has started coming out end of last year. These children are asking what to do at this point. What are you guys recommending for people who see this film that want to take the next step in terms of helping in some capacity? I mean, does the website help you? Where do you guys advise people to go?
Well, you can speak to that better.
I've said it so many times. You can go. You can say it. Go ahead.
Well, we've been recommending, right now the big issues are refugees. I mean, there's, 8 million refugees? Wow. On the borders. And, UNICEF in their, the Syrian Children Campaign?
Yes, for UNICEF. The UNHCR.
Yeah, that's another one where, if people are looking for places to donate, they're doing a great job in getting food and medical supplies, to these refugees on the border who just desperately need help.
And in terms of the film itself, what is the release strategy for it for people who want to check it out? Where will it be next?
Well, it's been doing the circuit through Europe. We go to, I think we're in New Zealand next week.
Wow.
And beyond that, I know we're in the UK, then we're in Italy. I think we've been in 10 or 15 countries already with just a really great reception to it. We've really been heartened by it. Seattle's our first domestic stop. So I'm sure it'll do the festival circuit, and then it will ultimately, I'm hoping for either a television or a theatrical release of some point, and then it'll ultimately, live where all documentaries go to live, on Netflix and iTunes.
Yeah, that's an interesting point. I was wondering about that when I saw it was 73 Men's. Is it something that you specifically had sort of constructed in any capacity thinking about television release, or even, with the way you guys are taking it to schools, making it some sort of element of a school course or something like that?
It kind of took me by surprise. I did not, in making the film, I did not realize we were going to get such an amazing response from high school and college-aged kids, and that's been worldwide. I mean, our, if I can use the term, super fans, the ones that wait outside the theater to meet us after screenings, tend to be 17, 18, 19, 20-year-olds. And I'm not surprised at it, but at the same time, I didn't set out to make that movie for them. In terms of the length of the film or thinking of terms of outside of where it might screen, other than that, we've been getting some really great interest from, in an area they call non-theatrical, which is, university screenings. Amnesty International, Czechoslovakia just called us. They're going to use the film as a must-watch for all volunteers so they can learn how to help refugees in their own country communicate with their own people in war-torn places. The U.S. Embassy in Sweden just called, and they want all to come speak, and they want to use the film so that they can help educate their staff, who can then later educate refugees in that country of how they can use social media to continue to help campaigns in their own countries, not just Syria, but any country similar. And I didn't expect that, but it's pretty awesome as a filmmaker to realize there's some people are looking at this as some parts of the film as educational, not just about what's going on in Syria, but almost as a how-to of, hey, how can we use social media in a way that's going to really impact some of these places?
Oh, fantastic. Thank you guys so much for joining me, Ala, Joe. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Everyone definitely needs to check out Chicago Girl Film. What's the website? ChicagoGirlFilm.com?
There you go. Yep.
All right. And you guys are on Twitter. I know you are, Ala. What's your Twitter for those who are not getting in contact?
My Twitter handle is @AlaBasatneh, AlaBasatneh.
I'm at Jay Piscatella, and the film's at Chicago Girl Film.
Awesome. Thank you guys again so much, and I wish you the best of luck.
Thanks.
Thank you. Stop me. I'm on fire tonight. Magneto can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. Even Zod can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. It's tight. Don't even try to buy the size. Mr. Spock can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. The Wrath of Khan can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. The Borg can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. Because I've got space game and it feels alright.